You are now listening to the Curtis King Podcast. What's going on with you music producers, and welcome to a new episode of the Curtis King Podcast. I, of course, am Curtis King. This podcast is specifically for music producers, but for also thinkers and creatives alike. If this is your first time listening on the traditional podcast platforms, I want to say thank you first and foremost for listening. Don't know how you got here, but I'm grateful that you are here. If you're somebody that's been here for a minute, I want to say thank you as well for your dedication to here. And also, if you haven't by now, leave us a rating, leave us some kind of commentary. If you've enjoyed a past episode, or if you enjoy this episode, leave some commentary, 5-star rating. It helps us as we move up the chart system here for podcast. That's first and foremost. Second, I got to make sure that I shout out my YouTube family. If you don't know, there's a video format of this podcast on my YouTube channel at Curtis King TV. That's Curtis with two S's. Curtis King TV on YouTube. Really easy to find. Just type in the Curtis King Podcast, two S's once again, and you will find this podcast as well as past episodes. It's been a really tough month for classic hip hop fans, right? We think about the loss of DMX, the loss of Black Rob, and man, now recently Shock G. And although I guess for more modern hip hop listeners, that may not be a name that is as popular. I mean, if you know, you know, right? You know Shock G. You know the significance of Digital Underground, the significance of what they brought to hip hop, especially in the early 90s. You know their significance to Oakland. You know their significance to ushering in and introducing us first to Tupac Shakur. If you know, you know. But for those who are not familiar with Shock G, and maybe the only thing that you know is Humpty, you know what I mean? You know the alter ego. It's important to note how much of an impact that Shock G had as a producer and an artist. It's really important to note that, especially because I know, you know, there are folks within my media circle that we're real good friends with Shock G. Never had the opportunity to meet him. I shook hands with him at Pay Dues, which is a hip hop festival that they had many, many years ago. And yeah, the energy is undeniable. It don't matter what era of Shock G that you experienced. Even if you're just now getting to know him because of the news of him passing away at 57, fam, that I don't think we realize how young 57 is, how young 50 is, right? For DMX, we don't realize how young that is. And as I'm just like, as I got the news, I was on live stream and I wasn't expecting it to hit me as hard as it did, but it did. And not because, like, you know, Shock was, I'm not going to sit up here in front like he was on my mind already. And, oh, I was just listening to him. But because of the impact he had early on in my career and my decision to want to even be a participant in hip hop instead of just being a listener, which what I was in the very beginning. I was just a listener, just someone who enjoyed the music. I felt like I was a part of the culture. I felt like my pops raised me on it. I felt like my mom's raised me on it. And I felt like I was always a part of the culture. But to be a participant, I always felt like, well, what kind of a voice could I have in hip hop if I wasn't living a certain lifestyle? If, you know, I may have lived in the neighborhoods that the rappers talk about, right? But I wasn't a street dude. You know what I'm saying? Like, if anything, I was like more goofy than anything else. Like just like making jokes and always trying to make people laugh. And like I was more comedian than anything else. And as I was trying to figure out my voice, and you have to understand, when Digital Underground was prime time, I was only like 5 or 6. But I remember my parents playing the music, specifically my dad. I remember playing the music. And I remember like laughing at, you know, Humpty as the alter ego of Shock G. And I remember just like laughing at the things he was saying, like, Owens got busy in the Burger King bathroom. Like, he just like listening to things like that made me feel like you could do this in hip hop and people are like embracing it. And my pops was the one that put me on the game, like more than embracing it. Like he is an important figure in this hip hop culture. Right. He gave another lane for folks to not be just as clean as, say, a Will Smith. I hate to keep using him as an example, but as clean as a Will Smith. But you can be that, and you could also, like, talk about adult content, or you could also, like, do that without being disrespectful, or do that without being tasteless. He found that balance and brought a level of fun to hip-hop that was hip-hop at its own nature. When you think about hip-hop being sort of the voice of the voiceless and always going, like, hip hop traditionally has always been about going against the norm and whatever the current norm is, right? If this is what, oh, that's cool, y'all rock with that. Our rebellious nature is what you're going to be attracted to, right? Rebellious against whatever the case may be. And I think that part of being hip hop, especially in a traditional sense, is being against the norm, even within hip hop. So sometimes it means rebelling against what it means to be hip hop. And I think that is hip hop. And I feel like Shock G and Digital Underground were the epitome of that. I remember going to sleep, you know, when I would go visit my mom on the weekends, I remember laying down and having like a tape player. And that tape player, it's funny how much I realized that tape player had so much to do with the music that I'm making now, because I didn't realize it, but by rewinding and pressing play, rewinding and pressing play, I was literally teaching myself the art of sampling and the art of looping. But I remember, and this is like only like 96, maybe 96, 97, I remember laying down on the floor as I'm going to sleep, had my tape player going, and remember going back, it was like a CD / tape player. And I would go back and forth from CD and tape. And I remember there was Sex Packets, right, by Digital Underground. And I remember like just playing songs over and over again, rewinding, going back, fast forward, rewinding, blah, 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 playing certain parts and like just loving the way that he used his voice, Shock G, the way that Shock G used his voice and made it sound like it was a completely different person. I remember growing up thinking that Humpty and Shock G were two different people because I'm just young and naive, right? I just didn't know no better, right? My pops had to put me on game. Like, no, that's the same person. But listening to that, I know, helped shape my voice and build my confidence early on when I decided to become a participant within hip hop as an artist, as an MC, as a producer. Like, he literally laid the blueprint. He literally opened up doors for folks like myself and maybe some of you out there that are artists / producers. And so I thought it was only right to honor the life and the legacy. Like, there's so much more that can be said, even aside from just the fun that he brought to hip hop. And also the funk aspect, right? Obviously, you could tell that George Clinton and Bootsie Collins were huge influences of his. And to capture that essence and bring it to 90s hip hop the way that they did. I mean, I remember as a kid listening back to this cassette tape and listening to the Humpty Dance and then hearing that bass line, that which it in a way became sort of like representative of what you expect from the Bay Area when it comes to bass lines, when we think about more modern Bay Area artists like Keek, and you think about E-40, he kind of like molded that early. Of course, you got to mention Too Short. But I remember listening to that like, yo, that sounds so damn cool. I want to do something like that one day. I don't know how. I don't know what I'm going to say, but I want to do something like that. And I just didn't expect when I got that news for it to hit as hard as it did. But it got me thinking, man. And there's a lot of things that I want to talk about today that are probably inspired by those events. And it may be unsettling to hear some of these things, I think, especially for my younger audience. It may be unsettling to hear these things. It may be even something where you're like, yeah, I'm not on that stage in my life yet, Curtis. So I'll get to it when I get to it. But I think it's still worthy of at least hearing it from someone. Right? Someone who loves hip hop, someone who has been a part of hip hop for, you know what I'm saying? Like, even beyond just my years participating in it, 18 years plus, for somebody that loves hip hop, for somebody that still to this day will play CL Smooth and Pete Rock, Reminisce Over You, Troy, they Reminisce Over You on repeat, Queen Latifah, UNITY, like all the classics that I feel an emotional attachment to when I heard I just hear certain instruments, right? As I said, UNITY, I'm thinking about the saxophone. One thing you will never call Mike hard on is my hip hop love, my love for hip hop, especially classic hip hop. But I never tried to position myself as being someone that is a purist about it, like, oh, music don't shine the same, it should shine like this all the time. No, I am all about the evolution of hip-hop. I'm so glad to see hip-hop go underneath so many different evolutions. I love to see the fact that it's gone from just being primarily in the major markets of New York and in L.A. to Atlanta to Texas to Florida to, you know what I'm saying, Bay Area, everywhere. Like, I'm glad to see that music is diversified the way that it is, in that the mainstreams and that everybody else is enjoying it. And, you know, there's some things about it that I think that as I grow older, as I get older, that don't resonate the same as they once did. But nonetheless, like, it's a beautiful thing to know that this culture that entered my life at a very young age and changed it is still changing lives of folks that are significantly younger than I. But the same way in any culture or any family structure, you start to realize the older that you get, not everything was sweet, right? And not everything that you learned within this family environment or structure environment was for your ultimate benefit. What am I talking about? I think that the older I get, the more I realize, and I want to speak from my experience because I think it'll probably be more helpful than me just making a statement about hip hop at large. But I think as I try to like wrap my mind around all of the OGs that we have lost that were barely getting into their OG years, right? As I think about all the ones that we have lost, as I watch videos of their last years on this earth, and as I watch, you know, sort of the way that they either kind of shy away from the public eye, or the way that I see them, you know, you see them and they appear happy. They appear in a peaceful place, but their eyes tell a story of, I'm just grateful to be here at this point. And not that there's anything wrong with being grateful, but I do feel that throughout our journeys as rappers, as music producers, the older we get, the more that the things that we have done that can be labeled toxic start to rear their head, right? For some people, it's an alcoholic addiction. For some people, it's a drug addiction. For some people, it's the way that they address other people. For some people, it's, you know, it's the way they do business is now taking a toll on them because they're starting to do things to people that they truly care about, but the way that they're showing it doesn't really represent that in the most accurate way. For me, I can tell you this. Some of the things that I have seen from my own character that were toxic, the number one thing that stands out is viewing other people like they're extras in my movie. What do I mean? I think that we all, to a certain degree, because we're focused and hyper-focused on our own lives, and we know we can only control our own lives, I think that we all get into a headspace that's like, I'm the main character of my movie. I think that's normal. But I think that as I started to come up and I started to make a commitment to becoming a successful producer, I want to be one of the best rappers. That pursuit of that goal made me view people who weren't in pursuit of their own goals, sometimes, if I'm being very transparent, as not as valuable, right? Or not as serious about their lives, or not as focused. And it caused me to be judgmental of other people. It also caused me to snap at other people who I felt were trying to slow me down, right? When a lot of times it was me being hypersensitive to that, and on a deeper level, fearful that I wouldn't make it. Fearful that if somebody stopped me for a second and said, wait, why are you doing what you're doing? What do you mean while I'm doing what I'm doing? I'm dedicated. I'm going after it. I'm somebody going after my dreams. What you mean? Chill. You going to tell me to slow? I ain't gonna, like, I was so defensive about when people would question my journey or question my decision making, especially because when I fell in love with music, I had it in my mind that nothing else mattered. Right? I had it in my mind that, I shouldn't say nothing else mattered, but of course family mattered, but I had it in my mind that it mattered more. Right? And we're going to get real vulnerable, real transparent today in a way that, like I said, it's going to make you uncomfortable. It definitely makes me uncomfortable. But I got into a place where how even like my family viewed me, I was so obsessive over my goals that I wasn't thinking about how things would be 20 years from then. I was so obsessive over my goals, and I was listening to these rappers who were telling me and giving me game. I thought were giving me game and saying like, yo, along the way, you're going to have to like get rid of your friends. You're going to have to get rid of the people that's, you know, and I was doing that. I was distancing anybody that wasn't aligned with my goals. And you know what? I understand when entrepreneurs and leading voices tell you, you know, you are a product of the seven people that you're around all the time. I get that. And I do believe that. I think that if you're around seven losers, you'll be the eighth one if you keep hanging around them. But I think that everything is not that black and white. And I think the older we get, the more we realize that it's okay to have imbalances in your life. It's more than okay. You need imbalances in your life. Sometimes you need them to test your growth. Sometimes you need them because you're not the only main, you're not the only character in this movie. Right? If there's 8 billion people, that means there's 8 billion movies around this world. And I think that we as entertainers, I guess you can say, or as producers, as artists, we get so wrapped up in our own movie that we start to treat everyone else like extras. At least I felt like I was getting that way. And when you treat everybody else like extras, you treat them subconsciously like they're disposable. Not indisposable, that like they are disposable. Like you can, yeah, okay, yeah, whatever. Like you were just another hater. And if I really look back, not every single person that said something negative or said something that challenged me was being a hater. Some people were asking legitimate questions. Another piece to this, when we're talking about toxic behavior, is who a producer or an artist can be within a relationship. And I'm not talking about business relationships. I'm not talking about friendships. I'm talking about relationship. boyfriend, girlfriend. Not every producer or artist is made the same. I get that. But I've hung out with a lot of folks like me. And we've had many of conversations in which we came to a general consensus that if your partner doesn't support you 100%, if your partner is not your biggest cheerleader or the biggest fan of your music, you give them the boot, right? Or until they are, you make them feel guilty for not being that. And the way that I justified that, because now when I say that, it feels like it feels so self-centered. Now, you know, the way that I justified it when I was pro that argument was, well, yeah, you got one life to live. And if your partner wants to see you happy, you know, that's part of your happiness. Is you working on music? Is you, you know, working late nights? Is you, you know, maybe not going to every event that your partner needs you to be at? Maybe not going to certain, you know, family or friend get togethers because you, I mean, you grinding, you're going after a goal. And I think that there is some truth to that, because if you want to have an extraordinary life, you got to do things in an extraordinary way. You have to carry extraordinary habits. You have to work at extraordinary hours. I get that. But I'm always curious about the folks that do make it to that other side. Was their goal just to achieve and make it to this destination, or was their goal happiness? Was their goal fulfillment? Was their goal control over their emotions? Was their goal to grow? Or was it just to attain a certain dollar amount? And I'm not here to judge anybody about that, but I got to know what my priorities are as I'm starting to desire this destination that's further on. And as I look at it, I realize a lot of the folks that give you this advice, they still deal with their own amount of bull, right? Your problems are not going to go away because you have a level of success, a level of making money. Your problems don't go away. Your problems just become better quality problems. So if that's the case, there's got to be flaws in any kind of advice that is being given. So when we talk about, and you know what? I got to actually pull this up because I forget the name of the movie, and I just watched the movie recently. It's about a drummer. And I gotta get the name of this. Whiplash. Oh my goodness. Such a great movie, but it gives me a great reference and example to what I'm getting ready to talk about now. We talk about relationships. So the main character, I don't want to give too much of the movie away, obviously. It came out in 2014, and the movie itself, let me see, was written and directed by Damien Chazelle, and it depicts the relationship between an ambitious jazz drummer, Miles Teller, and an abusive perfectionist bandleader, J.K. Simmons. And so this student is trying to get, what is the student's name, actually? I want to get all of this information. Make sure I get this. Hold on, let me get to the IMDb. This is important because I want to make sure that we get the full. So his name was Andrew. Drummer named Andrew. There's a teacher named Fletcher. The teacher, it comes off as a complete asshole. Andrew doesn't care. Andrew was dedicated to this goal. Andrew wants to become the greatest drummer of all time, right? He is the epitome of the producer that stays up all night long trying to go after this goal. Andrew is so dedicated that his hands are bleeding from him practicing. He is so obsessive, he's not going to sleep. He meets a young lady at a movie theater. He likes this young lady. He starts to date this young lady. And then he realizes that if he wants to be as great as he says he wants to be, he's going to have to dump her. And does he dump her? I'm sorry to give it away. Yes, he does dump her. And he dumps her in such a cold way. And I don't know if I would have saw it as cold if I was not 36. When I was in my 20s, I'd have been like, hell yeah, drop her. Drop her. You got to go after your dreams. I think that would probably be me. Oh, head ass. That would have been me. But now that the older I get, the more I realize there's some toxicity in that behavior of giving people the boot because you feel like your movie is more important than other people's lives. You feel like your movie, right? And to a certain degree, you could argue your happiness, which your happiness is important. But if the goal is happiness, right? If you go further into that movie, he finally is starting to connect the dots. He goes through a crazy, crazy, crazy set of events. And years later, he starts to finally get into that bag that he wanted to get into to become the greatest drummer that he could ever become. One of the greatest of all time. Not even just him. He wanted to be the greatest of all time. As he starts to get into that bag, he calls her up, the girl that he dumped and kicked to the side. And he's like, yo, hey, I just wanted to invite you out. You know what I'm saying? I kind of miss that old thing we had. And she didn't moved on. She moved on. She got a new man. She's like, yeah, let me check with my boyfriend and see. And he's all like, oh, okay. You've moved on. You've got a life. Oh, wait a minute. You're supposed to be an extra in my movie. What are you going out there having a life for? I mean, that's toxic, man. I think that is something that we have to recognize that everybody is not extras on the side waiting for us to be successful. Yes, in our line of work, we do get to become the center of attention because of our talent. Our talent does make us extraordinary. But our pursuit of a goal does not. And I think sometimes we allow that to be an excuse to be toxic to other people. I know I have. I know that there are friendships and relationships that I have cut off that have been the reason why I found success. Right? If we're going to keep it a stack, it's been the reason why I found success. Why? Because I had less time to dedicate to where are we kicking it at? Where are we going to go party at? Where are we going? I had less time to think about that and more time to focus, which you can make a crazy argument for. I just think that the manner in which I did it, it ultimately led me back to trying to reconnect with these people when I became successful. Because here's the thing about it. You pursue an extraordinary life, just as Andrew in that movie. Now you have an extraordinary amount of success, but also an extraordinary amount of time. Now here you are, free on a Thursday afternoon, when those friends that you gave the boot, right? Those past relationships you gave the boot, them folks that you were like, you're not as important of a character in my movie, the ones you gave the boot. Now when you try to reconnect with them because there's a part of you that says, you know what? I was a bit of an asshole then, and I kind of want to make that right. They've moved on. Why? Because they're the main characters in their movie as well. The Curtis King Podcast is proudly sponsored by the Vaclia Doubler. What is a doubler? Well, I think better than telling you, I should show you. You trying to tell me I can use this microphone to make beats, to make melodies, to make chord progressions? I can use my voice? I'm all in. Pretty cool, right? Check this out. The Vaclia Doubler represents the future of making music. The Vaclia Doubler is a real-time voice recognition MIDI controller. It offers up a never-before-seen way to translate your musical ideas into reality using the one instrument you've been practicing since birth, your voice. Make more of the music you love without having to worry about how to get your ideas into your DAW. Before the Doubler even sponsored this podcast, I picked it up just because I'm a geek about technology. And I personally picked up the Doubler Studio Kit, which allows you to hum a melody, a synth pattern, or even beatbox one-shots right into FPC if you use FL Studio or whatever DAW that you're using. This also allows you to manipulate effects and filters in a way that only the voice can. To get the Studio Doubler Kit, all you gotta do is access getdoubler.com/Curtis King. When you get an extraordinary amount of free time, now you have extraordinary hours and people cannot just connect with you because they don't have the same lifestyle. It puts you in a place where now, when you have pursued to be a part of the 5 or 10% of the population that can do what you do, I'm just making up numbers. You now have to deal with the circumstances. Part of those circumstances is that you are probably only friends. The majority of friends you have are folks who are doing the same thing. Which is cool. That's cool. Good to have some comrades. Good to have some folks that understand what you're doing. But after a minute, it will get a bit boring. You want balance. You don't want to. And if we're being completely 1000 about it, it will get very lonely because if you're around the people that are doing the same things, that means that they have extraordinary goals as well. And that means that they're probably taking on hours that are even more extraordinary than yours. So that means they probably don't have a lot of time to just kick it. That's the nature of it. So I think that now, as I get older, I start to realize, damn, so there was a toxic nature in the way that I treated people in general because I felt like my goals were more important than their pursuit of their goals when I wasn't there and showing up for them and supporting them, which I think is another huge thing, is that we get so wrapped up in our goals, and although it is more important to your life, we get angry at other people for being as aggressive about their goal pursuit and not supporting us. And maybe some people understand where I'm coming from. Maybe some people think that that's, what do you mean? Like that's common sense. It's self-centered. And I'm talking for myself. It's self-centered. Your dreams are so much more important than anybody else's pursuit of their dreams that you can't support them, but you're mad that they don't support you. I see artists and I see producers get angry all the time on social media about people not supporting them. And then when I ask them behind closed doors, well, what are you doing to support those you are looking for support from? You know what I'm saying? I leave comments on their page all the time. Comments? That's support? That's the only support you got for them? You know what I'm saying? Like, I show love all the time. Like, you know, I throw like fire emojis in their DM. That's it? That's your support? What was the last, I'm talking pre-pandemic. When was the last graduation you attended? Right? What was the last birthday party you attended? I don't got time for parties, Curtis. I'm out here trying to get mine. Respect, salute. But how can you expect you to put a pause on your support of everybody else because of your pursuit of your goal and still expect them to turn around and pause their lives for yours? I don't sound kind of twisted. I know that it took me a long time to see that. So if you have objection to it, I'm not mad at that. I want you to. Because at least if you're questioning it, it means that you recognize that there's an imbalance there. Nothing wrong with imbalance. I believe in imbalance more than I believe in balance. But I got to plant the seed. Because I think that as I think about my OGs and I think about how they appear in those last years, they look like they've been carrying a lot. And not just the stress of the industry, but I think also the stress of how they've interacted with other people. The stress of, damn, could I have handled this a lot better? Especially the ones that find supreme success in what they're doing. Right? They have monumental success. For anybody, it's very easy for them to get into a headspace where, once again, it's that I'm the main character in my movie and everybody else is an extra. Right? I was that kid that when I used to watch movies, I used to wonder about the extras. Right? Like when you see somebody you see the two main characters talking to each other and having like a real crazy dialogue, I used to look in the background and be like, I wonder what that couple story is. They're casually having a conversation. I wonder if they know anything about them. I wonder if they're overhearing this conversation. I don't know why, but I've always been interested in knowing that other side of the story. And the more that I progress in this, the more that I realize my life has become a lot more wholesome. And I think people get the wrong idea when they hear the term wholesome. But I think that my life has become a lot more wholesome because it's a lot more whole, and that I'm looking at things from more than just my perspective, more than just what I want, more than just, like, I have so much empathy now for my exes throughout my life, right? I'm appreciative of them because they ultimately led me to my beautiful and amazing wife that I have now, the mother of my child. But I can only imagine the asshole that I was throughout my years. Not on purpose, not because I was trying to make someone feel terrible, but I can imagine the asshole that I was when they would invite me to go to, like, family, not family, but like friend get togethers or whatever, maybe even family get togethers. And I'd be like, oh my God, when are we leaving? What do you mean? We just got here. I should be working on music right now. Okay, you can't wait till tomorrow? No, I got the grind every day, 24 hours a day. You feel me? I'm out here trying to get it. I ain't trying to be second best. I'm trying to be number one. Could you just sip this and chill out? No. What you mean chill out? Like, I can only imagine, and this is me like giving an exaggeration of a younger Curtis, but I can only imagine how selfish I might have been. Right? To think that because I want to be this rapper and I want to be this producer, my life is more important than theirs. Right? I remember myself, and it's embarrassing to say, being judgmental of my significant other, not having a goal as big as the one that I had. Right? I remember getting offended when I would share things like, I want to become a billionaire, right? Or I want to be this. And then they had a lukewarm reaction to it. I remember being like offended by that. Ego going crazy. I remember situations in which I did a show, and this is years and years and years and years ago. I did a show and I felt like I just killed it. I was pumping my chest out. The crowd was with me as a rapper. The crowd was with me. And I saw my girl at the time. Had her elbow on this guy's shoulder, and I was so like pumped up, and I looked over, I'm like, the hell are you doing over there? You should be over here hugged up on me. It sounds so unlike me, right? But that was me. I was like, what you doing? Who is that? I remember walking over like, who the hell is this? And she was like, this is what are you tripping off of? Go back over there and sign your autographs and do what you're doing. I remember being so offended, and we got in a huge argument that night. And I look back on it and I'm like, it didn't matter if I wasn't a household name. Even having some local notoriety had my head ballooning up, had me thinking about life in such an unreasonable way, had me treating folks that I said that I cared about, but I had a conditional love for. I was convinced it was unconditional, but it was a conditional love. If you don't support me, then it's not real. It's bull. That's bull. That's bull. I don't even give them an opportunity. Like, let me show you how bullish that is. I don't even give them an opportunity to be a human being. Like, this is steel. Yes, you're my significant other, and yes, you want to see me happy, and you are, you know, either we're supporting one another, or we're getting in each other's way. We're either adding to each other's lives or we're taking away, right? Those still apply no matter what you do as a profession. But I didn't even give the person that I was with an opportunity to say, or even have an opinion about what their favorite music is. Now, all of a sudden, because you're in a relationship with this person, they have to like everything that you do? No. They have to support everything that you do? No. They don't. They're still entitled to their opinion. I think that there's a way to be supportive of a human being, but have doubts about their decision making when they get excited or when they get emotional, then that's okay. To question the decision making, I think a healthy relationship, which is something that those are two words that I definitely have not cared about until I got older. And I realized that an unhealthy relationship can literally take years off of your life. Whether you are the unhealthy partner or you have one, when I realized that, now I care so much more about that. And trying to make the changes within myself to make it a healthy environment so that I can live a long life, long, prosperous life, as well as my partner and my little one. But when I think about the things that made those unhealthy environments, I think about the toxic behaviors that I carried. I think about the toxic, and I keep saying toxic because I didn't understand that until I had, it wasn't even somebody who told me it was toxic. I just had to sit with it and say, what is life for the people on the outside of my studio? What is life like for the people on the outside of my studio? Yes, I'm in pursuit of my goals. My goals just happen to be really, really loud. Music's banging. They don't get their peace. Right? Well, they should understand. I get that. I was that to a T. Life still goes on. All those hours we spend making beats, all those hours we're in here pursuing this goal, and they understand that. And you know, most of the time they're with it, sometimes they're not with it. But I think that immediately making them the enemy, because they don't think how we think and don't understand how we understand or don't have the passions that we have, I think it's unfair. I think it is something that the older I get, the more I realize. And it's ironic, man, because I was looking through one thing that I do after someone influential musically or just in general passes away. I look at the words they left behind. It was no different than Nipsey. It was no different from Kobe. It was no different from Shock G, DMX. I look back at the interviews. I look back at the gems that they left behind. And I look to see if they leave any clues that I can learn from. One thing I can say for sure with Shock is there was a video that I watched the other day, and he was apologizing to a young lady that he was, I guess, at one point dating. And he said when he was in the prime of his career, he had just killed the show and he was feeling himself. He was feeling himself, right? Got off stage and he seen the girl, and I guess they weren't dating anymore. And he was dating somebody else, or he just had a bunch of girls around him. I mean, there's a video. He literally is apologizing. But I guess he said some things to her and put her business out there. And you could see it in his eyes. He was like, it was just the time period. No excuses. He was like, I apologize. I'm putting your business out there. He said, I felt sick to my stomach after it happened. And I think about things that I may have said or you know, ways that I had that were justified by my pursuit of this goal, but it was at the expense of other people's lives and time and emotion and needs. And I think to myself, instead of carrying that, all I can do is pray for those that were in contact of the ultra dedicated and aggressively goal pursuing Curtis King. Wish for them the best, but also make sure that the greatest thing that I can do at this stage in my life, especially for the family that I have now, is to truly heal those things. First, identify. Because the first thing people do when they recognize things are going on, first thing they do is try to kill it. Got to heal it before you kill it. Before you heal it, you have to identify it. So identify the things that you look at and say, replace my profession with something else? Is this something that would cause some kind of an issue? Is this something that feels balanced with my personality? Because some people are just assholes and don't care. I get it. You do you. But for those who are similar to me, have a bit of a conscience, right? Identify that these things exist. Because guess what? Even after your success, you become ultra successful, they're not going away. They're not going away. You're still going to have that feeling within you that's like, damn, oh man, like, damn, I shouldn't have, back in this year, I said, oh, that's not, the success feels dirty sometimes. Like money just doesn't make that go away. Identify the things that you think are toxic. Once you identify them, start making steps to not just get rid of them, but to understand them. Then try your best to understand it from another perspective. Right? When I think about the family members that I was like, oh, you know, I feel like you should have been more supportive of my career. I think about what that would have done to me at a young age where I was already feeling myself. I think about the dangers that are the vulnerable situations I found myself in that had it not been for the person I thought was a naysayer, I would have been in a situation which I may not even be here if it had not been for their forewarning, right? Had it not been for them saying, I don't know about that. You should definitely be careful. Who knows? But what I can say, after you identified, after you understand it, after you empathize with the folks that have been around you, only then can you make room for the new person, the new you. But in order for that new you to make their way, it is going to be a slow and painful death to kill this old toxic you. And even after you kill it, the new person, the new you that comes through, the one that I am working on daily, still going to have his flaws. It's not going to be flawless, never going to be flawless. It'll just be a different layer with a different quality of bruises and scrapes, right? But recognizing that and knowing that life is an endless pursuit of not just hiding how you feel and compressing these feelings and just trying to get rid of them, right? Life is an endless pursuit of understanding, establishing boundaries, and then growing, and then growing, and then growing. Thank you for listening to the Curtis King Podcast. I hope today's episode helped you. I know for me, I love doing these because they're almost like public journal pieces for me. These podcasts are public journal pieces, and I feel like it's good to speak it from your own existence because I think that a lot of folks, they have these thoughts, but they're not always shared because this is not traditional producer content. But hell, we're in 2021, and the conversation around mental health, I think, is more strong than it's ever been. It's the strongest it's ever been. And I'm excited to see us be in such healthy mental headspaces and physical headspaces or physical spaces that we can live longer. We can prosper longer. That's something I want my OGs to be here longer. And when I become an OG, I want to be here longer, right? I want to be here long. Because beyond the work that I'm doing now, like, I'm not working this hard just to die when I finally get it. I'm looking to enjoy it, the fruits of my labor. But a lot of us are not able to see what the end of this looks like, right? So thank you for listening. Definitely leave us a 5-star rating on your traditional podcast platforms. Video definitely on the YouTube channel. Make sure that you come check us out. But then also, if you're already watching this, leave us a thumbs up. Want to say thank you once again to our sponsor, Vocalia Doubler. And yeah, give us some thought. is all I'll say. In this life, you will not be full of life until you decide to live life to its fullest. Once again, it's Curtis King of the Curtis King Podcast. Have a good one.